Well, I think we're going to go ahead and get started here. Welcome, all of you, to Bullseye Projects, in case you don't know where you are. And I am, for those of you that I don't already know, Lonnie McGregor, director here of Bullseye Projects, and also co-owner with my partner and life and business, Dan Schwoerer. Our panelists, Tom Jacobs and Bo Hagood. I haven't gotten a lot of sleep in the last few days. And what we're going to talk about today is actually a project that we've been doing together for about the last 6 months, and this has to do with the transformation of a space. It also happens to be the space that we live in, and it involves something that we're very particularly excited about, and that is the crossover of materials. I apologize. We only just finished this project exactly a week ago. So the photography that you will see here is a little amateur. It's mine. And we will be soon photographing it professionally. To start off, I'll tell you a little bit about more of the project after we get through our own introductions, starting with myself. And as I mentioned, I'm the director of Bullseye Projects. Bullseye Projects until January of 2015, was a fairly traditional gallery that showed artwork made with the glass that is made at our factory in Southeast Portland. In the last year and a half, we've opened it up to much more interactive sort of activities. Some of which are directed at various ages. So although we continue also to do exhibitions, we also oversee the artist residency programs, which happen at the factory but are essentially curated here. The space you're sitting in right now is typically a children's educational project, which sometimes spills over into the streets. And we help to facilitate the studio projects that happen over on the other side of the river where Bullseye Glass Company is. And I'm going to ask my partner, Dan, to talk a little bit about the background of Bullseye as he was the founder 42 years ago. So, Dan.
All right. Well, thank you all for coming. I went to school in Madison, Wisconsin in the 60s. It was sort of the Berserkly of the Midwest, and didn't know really how to start a business or do anything, but we were very impassioned about glass, and at that time it was glass blowing. So when Professor Littleton asked me where I was going to go after school, I said, well, I'm thinking Portland, Oregon. And he said, no, don't go to Portland, Oregon. Go to Seattle or San Francisco because everybody just flies over Portland. And I thought, wow, that's the place to go. Because in the 60s, if your professor or your parents or anybody in authority told you not to do something, you knew exactly that was what to do. So that's what got me to Portland. And really started very quickly a small little blowing shop and then convinced Ray Algren, who I knew who was in this program in Madison, to come out. And we blew glass and went to art fairs across the country and basically couldn't hardly make a living because people would look at it and go, well, you know, they understood ceramics, but what was this blowing glass stuff, right? But we'd always run into people who needed stained glass and were trying to make windows. So we got the idea, hey, we could start a glass company to make sheet glass, make a fortune. And we decided a fortune was $100,000, go back to blowing glass. So that's why we started Bullseye. And we've always been at Bullseye a company that was about education. I don't think we ever lost that feeling of it's a graduate program and you share the information. So that's what got us into it. And we've just kept growing. And today we're, as you know, 42-year-old company with 150 employees, and we get to do lots of wonderful things with our glass.
And at the core of the company still is what Dan always hoped it would never stop being, and that is an educational program. And the department that manages that is Tom's department. It's called Bullseye Studio. It's within the larger department of research and education. So Tom, can you talk a little bit about, you know, your own background too, what got you to Bullseye and what this department is about?
Yeah, absolutely. My background is I came out of a sculpture program at Hampshire College in Amherst, Massachusetts. What brought me to Portland was more or less that it seemed like a really great place to move to. And because of the vibrant arts culture that started to develop here when folks like Dan came out here and started building companies like Bullseye. And so, I came into the company as an instructor. This was 12 years ago now.
Wow.
No, it's been a while, right? I was an instructor for a number of years. I've been within the research and education department the entire time I've been working at Bullseye, even though my job description has changed. You know, it's very much about the process-based research, gathering the information about how to use this material more effectively, and push the limits, push the boundaries, and then take everything that we've learned and be able to communicate that then to the people who are buying our glass and using it, so helping everybody use it more effectively. And that's, you know, the Bullseye Studio is just an extension of that same idea. We've always been working with artists, and the studio is just a more formal way of executing those projects and gaining that really valuable information.
Great. I think one of the things that I think must make your job particularly challenging is that you are on the one hand doing rather formal fabrication work, but mm-hmm. at the same time juggling artists who are running amok.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The Artist in Residence program takes place within Bullseye Studio, and that again is an extension of the research that we're doing. So, you know, yes, on the one hand, we've got clients who are, you know, very traditional clients needing, you know, they need a table, they need a counter, they need very discrete functional things that are delivered on time and have all of the right characteristics that they ordered in the first place. And then we have, simultaneously, we've got folks in the studio who are, you know, doing the exploration and doing the limit pushing kinds of work of seeing, okay, what can I make this material do for me as an artist? It is an interesting juxtaposition to be doing those paid projects and then also be immersed in that excitement that people bring to the material when they're you know, pushing the boundaries.
Right. So, in pushing the boundaries, we we pushed our way into the wood world, and we've known each other for quite some time. Bo Hagood is founder and head of MADE, a design build mm-hmm, operation right. here in Portland, and. And the reason I have this image up behind here is because I'm a huge fan of Bo's, and particularly of this table, which I'll talk about a little bit more later. But Bo, if you'll talk about your background and what your studio does.
Yeah, sure. I graduated from College of Charleston, South Carolina with a philosophy degree because I've never made many good practical decisions in my life, and that was definitely one of the less practical. But it did lead me onto a journey that eventually led me to Portland, Oregon. I moved to Portland because my girlfriend moved here, and that was 20 years ago. And at that time, she's now my wife, and we have a kid, so that worked out. But at the time, I had never really built anything. I think I was brought up in a family that expected me to get a real job and get a house and have some kids and live in Greenville, South Carolina. That was going to be my outcome. But moving out here kind of gave me some freedom to experiment, and I took one class at Oregon College of Art and Craft just on a knack in furniture making, and I came home that day and I told Karen, I said, this is it, this is what I'm gonna do for a living. I mean, one class is all it took, so I knew I was passionate about it. I had no idea what I was getting into, and I knew I had a lot to learn, so I went to school for 2 years at OCAC, and after graduating, I worked for a company called Altura Furniture that's kind of a medium production furniture shop, learned some tricks there. and then set out on my own, made my first commission, which took over 2 months to build, and I think I charged $5,000 for it. So that was a learning experience. And then just one thing kind of came together, one thing would follow another, and I just really started finding that my pleasure in woodworking was the details, you know, where joints came together, simplicity, form. I kind of started very garish in my design, and then I would just strip it down to the bare essence of things. One thing led to another, good projects would come along, and I just kept working really hard to make sure that my customers were really satisfied with what I gave them. And before you knew it, now we have 5 people working in the shop, me in the studio trying to orchestrate this chaos and doing amazing collaborations with people like Bullseye. So.
And the amazing collaboration that we're going to talk about right now was, as I mentioned, inspired. It was inspired by a couple of things. One thing was a ceiling in my house that I've always hated, and the other thing was a table that I bought at an OCAC auction, one of Bo's Cascade tables here. And when you see the site where this all started, it may make some sense to you. This is kind of midstream. We had ripped out what we had, which was our home very much serves as a gallery, as a showcase for the work that we collect, which is the work made by the artists that we work with. And this entire space for the last 15 or 20 years has been black because the major piece in it demanded a black background. But we during the last remodeling that we did, we left town and they put the wrong ceiling in. They put a knotty cedar ceiling in. And I looked at that ceiling for the longest time and it just never made any sense to me. And then I bought the table and I kept thinking that above and below, somewhere in there, was something magic going to happen between this wood ceiling and this wood table. So it was the very first project that I approached Bo with. Actually, I think that was one more project than we expected to do because Dan thought all we were going to do was a paint job. I said, can we paint the top floor, dear? And he said, yes. And by the way, there's this table that we have, which wasn't large enough, so we commissioned a larger one, which even though it was the very first project of this series of projects that we've done together, it's the one that isn't finished yet. Yeah, right. because the table is so good that we've got to find some glass design that really will set it off. But so what we ended up doing was 8 separate projects, 4 of which were actually collaborations between glass and wood and involved some very close connections, and others were more individual, just because as I fell in love with what Bo does, I ended up commissioning some things that we sort of hadn't quite expected. Yeah. But as collectors of glass art, having a space to show that made a lot of sense, and this is shelving unit is amazing. The touch to the metal elements in it turns the lights on. I'm not real crazy about places to put glass art on shelves. This one I adore. Another piece that was done for a sort of collection that we have of whiskey was supposed to be a collaborative glass and wood. But we haven't finished with the glass yet, or I guess we just finished with it, so we put the granite back on for a moment. Another project, which was strictly a glass project, was the counter. It's a cast glass, I would call it a stepped glass bar. You can see from the edge of it what that stepping is. This was another sort of afterthought. This screen, which we had never planned, and we just plopped it on Bo one day. We said, hey, how about this wall? Can't you do something there? And it suddenly probably put the project about a month later.
It put the fire in our butts, I'll tell you.
But with all the glass, when you have a lot of glass in a space, one of the things that we love about glass is the translucency. Wood is not translucent, screens are. So it made a beautiful, on the left you can, it's on the left? No, it's on the right. You can see that transition between a glass counter, a glass partially glass and wood door, and the light that comes through this screen is quite remarkable. Now, the pieces that we really collaborated on, the front door, which you would have seen in the background of that prior shot, which is a slab of Oregon maple.
That was maple, right?
Maple. Yeah. And cast glass. I'm going to let you guys talk about these things a little bit more. I'm going to just keep going right through the... This one is one of my favorites, cabinetry. We never, as glassmakers, would have thought to make the glass into the handle. Mm-hmm. This was Bo's idea, and I thought a really brilliant piece of design work. The final piece, the sort of pièce de résistance, which I like to call the fault, the fault table. It also was very collaborative. To go back to the beginning of the project, at Bullseye, we tend to think about the material in terms of its origins, because we make the glass literally from the sand all the way through to the sheets, to the final fabricated pieces. So it seemed like a romantic thing to do, to go back to the origins of both of these materials. So we invited the teams. Bo's team from MADE came to the factory and saw how glass was made, and we went out to the forest. I don't know what I was thinking, that you grew your trees, but...
In this case, we kind of did. I mean, we at least know the trees we got.
Yes. So early on, actually, Bo, can you maybe talk a little bit about what your impressions were of the material when you saw it at the factory?
Yeah, it was amazing. I think wood and glass just in general have so many differences with how they look and feel, and you can't drop glass, it will shatter. And I found that going through the factory, everything was so, just felt so much more scientific and thought out and plotted than what we're usually doing with wood. I mean, your organization systems were amazing. The piles of different colorants, that, you know, everything is perfectly measured and weighed out to within the, I don't know, what would it be, a nanopound? Is that it? And everything was just so vibrant and moving. It was a moving machine like I'd never seen. And that's one thing that really impressed all of us, was just the organization of a structure. And we are always feeling a little bit in chaos mode, where things go wrong, you're trying to come up with a design solution. Wood is always moving on us, so we're trying to deal with that. But it felt like you guys had really dialed something down.
Ooh,
there, which was
bought that, huh?
Yeah, which was great for us. I mean, it's inspiring, because we're always trying to find that level of efficiency and getting rid of all the clutter. And that was one thing that struck us all the most. I think we Instagrammed, probably every one of my employees Instagrammed the storage room where you keep the racks of the colored glass, and you're looking down the aisle and you see all the colors just blending together, and it's, you don't even see it anymore, I can tell. But walking in there, it's just amazing. We were all just so awestruck.
To me, it almost looks like glass bark.
Right, yeah, because it's got had that same live edge on it. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's a good point.
So yeah, walking into the forest was pretty pretty inspirational for us. Tom, what did it feel like to you?
Oh, I mean, it was great to get outside during the middle of the workday, for starters. That was nice. I think the thing that really struck me being there and speaking with the people who harvest the wood and process the wood, and seeing how that process works, it really kind of put me in my place in terms of the time scale that we were a part of. In fabricating glass, we'll have pieces that'll be in the kiln for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. We'll have multiple pieces like that. It'll take months to finish a project. And to us, that's just normal. To clients who are used to working with things that have a shorter time scale, you know, they expect to get it in 2 weeks, and that seems like a really long time. But I like to think of myself as, you know, of having a pretty firm grasp of, things take a while. But being there and seeing, wow, okay, so, you know, they take this tree down, and then it has to go through this whole process of drying really carefully. It has to be stored in a very specific way for anybody can even do anything with it. And then before any of that stuff even happens, I mean, the tree has to grow. You know, you're out there in the forest and figuring out, wow, you know, how old are these trees that have been here? And And just, you know, the glass, as long as it may feel like it takes to us, is just a blink of an eye, you know, next to the all of the time that went into the wood component of it. And that was kind of what struck me while I was out there.
Dan, did you have particular impressions of the...
Well, first I was so taken, it's Zena is the forester, and it's just this wonderful family that's, I think, several generations have owned and operated this small forest, and how close they were attached to the forest.
Mm-hmm.
I've never thought of somebody being that attached to a forest, yeah. Right?
I mean, literally, Doomling,
right. Yep.
Grew up as a child in the forest,
right.
And the house that they built there is a very almost Grimm's fairy tale kind of German. Mm-hmm. You liked it because they're German of origin. Yeah. So it's a very Bavarian house in the forest.
Well, and it does not look like any type of agriculture you've ever seen. It is a living, working forest. I mean, and by working, I don't mean people working. I mean it is there for nature. And they take such great care of it and such great pride of it. For me as a woodworker, it was a pleasure to go there too, because we're often two steps removed. I mean, by the time we get it, it's out of the kiln and we don't really know the source of it. So to have that source in our own backyard and seeing the trees and seeing the wood that we knew was going to the kiln for our project was amazing.
No, that intimate knowledge of the material and the material from its origins is a beautiful, as the recipient of these objects, it had huge meaning for us. I mean, we now live with things that we feel almost the DNA of where it all came from, and that's pretty special. Beyond the material, where these things come from is often also largely determined by the culture of the spaces that remake them. And I would really like Tom and Bo to talk about the culture of your environment. And this is Bullseye Studio on a really learning day.
That was a good day to learn things. As we were talking about earlier on in the introductions, we are a part of the research and education department, and research is a critical component of Bullseye Glass Company. And when we say research, sometimes that means, we're looking at things in microscopes and putting it in fancy instrumentation and learning things about the material properties. But mostly what we mean by research is process-based research and learning how to use the material and harness the material and the ways of working with it. And the picture that Lonnie's got up there was a really good learning day. That was from a project we did with an artist named June Kaneko, who some of you may know. He had a really particular effect that he wanted to see come out of the glass, and that effect occurred almost accidentally as we were trying to develop a process to do a different body of work. He really liked the accidental result that we got from that, and then developed a whole body of work around that accidental result. So then we had to take that accident and figure out how to do it on purpose. And this was one of the results of that. We had a whole another accident. It's a pretty difficult thing to open up a kiln that's been annealing your glass for the last couple of weeks and see that glass all over the inside of the kiln. The second response, which for me happens within seconds, is okay, let's figure out what happened and let's learn from it and develop a better method. The outcome of this was we learned a tremendous amount about how to both harness and control the material within the kiln. And it changed the way that we built kiln furniture. It changed the way that we loaded and fired the glass in the kiln. And then we took all of that information and we've got classes that now delve deeply into those very topics, the very things that we learned coming out of this this really difficult failure. And it's something that, you know, we take risks. We push beyond the safe thing, even though the safe thing might be the more profitable thing. It's not helping grow the possibilities of what can be done in the future. And so we're always out there taking risks because we can't not take risks, and we're in a position to be able to do it in a way that other fabrication studios wouldn't be able to. So it's a responsibility and a pleasure to set ourselves up for
pleasure to fail.
Yeah.
Set ourselves up for some failures that we can learn from.
Was there anything on this project particularly that went wrong that you learned something from? I don't want to hear about the things that went wrong you didn't learn anything from.
on this series of projects? Let's see. Do you have one?
You can think about it.
I mean, most of mine was really just witnessing what was going on your ends. I mean, similar kind of breakage things that we don't deal with on a regular basis, that it seems like you guys at this point just go, it broke. And I'm like, it broke? I mean, that's a pretty big deal, right? We'll recast it. It's glass. So
I got an image of something that that you hid in the back of one of your projects.
Oh, yeah, well, phew, you made me nervous there for a second. Now I know what you're talking about.
I love, this is my favorite. It wasn't a mistake, unless the guy didn't survive. But, you know, tell us about what's going on here.
So the great thing about wood is it is a natural material, and you can find things in wood that are a little piece of history. This happens to be a bullet that was shot out at Xenophores Products one day, probably 50 years ago. And when we were planing the wood down, we opened it up. And the nice thing about bullets is they're lead, so they're softer than the carbide on your tool blade, so it's not a big deal. We also find barbed wire from time to time, which is not so fun. We found it, and then we didn't really want to highlight it. We didn't want to make the whole piece become about the bullet, but we also didn't want to get rid of it. So we just gently turned the board around and put it on the inside of this one cabinet, so whenever you want to see the bullet, it's there.
Well, I want to see the bullet all the time, so I open this cabinet a lot.
Yeah.
In fact, I can't even put anything in the cabinet because it would obstruct the view of the of the bullet. So the material, moving from material to design. You know what probably made this a bit of a challenge for you, Bo, at least. Tom's probably more used to taking Dan's ideas, but you were really kind of under the gun from a client who put their face in it a lot.
What was
that like?
That's better than the alternative, actually, quite frankly. I don't know exactly how the story goes, but there's a thing where someone says, hey, I want you to make me something, so you make it for me, take it for me, that's too big, make it again, and then you take it to them, it's like, that's too small. I love nothing more than having input from clients, because it gives me an idea of what they want. I'm assignment-driven in terms of a designer. I don't sit down, wake up one morning, and say, I'm gonna come up with this new idea and come up with it. I like people to challenge me with something that they want and help bring that to reality, because there's a lot more than just, hey, I have an idea. There's a lot on the back end that is always taken for granted, that I enjoy working through those details. Mm-hmm. So I think this was probably me trying to sell Dan on something. I'm not quite sure what. But I think in the end, that's what made this project such a success, is because there was that additional input. And not to mention, now I know you guys are happy with it because we discussed it enough up front to where I was comfortable knowing what you wanted.
Yeah. Well, at the very start, if we didn't actually have a formal design brief, but I may have given you a sort of list of the kinds of things we wanted. There were sort of more thematic kinds of things.
Right.
It was driven by what we already had, which was a space that was, again, I had mentioned earlier, was driven by a particular piece of art, the one on the right-hand side, which made the whole room black. And so we were looking for things that were light, airy, transparent, with a more material emphasis on them. I'm going to go back to you in your design skills.
That's my son's on the right. Just for the record.
But you design in a lot of different ways. You both work with a pencil.
Pencil on the fly. I tend to, unbelievably, I kind of just go straight to the computer now, and I can't really explain. I think it's because I am somewhat anal retentive, and I can get the exact proportion as I'm drawing, and I've gotten really efficient at it. Mm-hmm. And then on the fly, when I'm trying to alter things or explain things in the shop or to Dan, you know, then I do my scribbles, which sometimes work and sometimes not quite so much. But yeah, the designing for me is always kind of an organic process. It starts with an idea, and I don't spit something out the next day. I like to stew on it. It stays in the back of my head, and then when it's time to put the pencil to paper or fingers to the keyboard, whichever it is, you know, that's when it really, it goes straight from writing rough idea to refining the details immediately.
Very different. Dan also sort of lives with a pencil in his hand.
Yeah.
He's always scribbling. I think this is you trying to compress his head either or keep it from exploding. But on the right hand side, the sort of scribbling that Dan does, and this was in the process of making the design for the door.
Right.
Dan, do you want to talk about what it was for you in terms of the designing of these pieces?
Sure. Yeah, in the case of the door, I wanted, obviously it needed a support to carry the hinges, the weight of the glass, which was, the total door weight was about 650 pounds, I think. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to keep the steel very minimal, and the real challenge was, as you can see, the bottom of the steel, I think, is 2 inches, 2x2, and then the rest of it's 1x2, so it's pretty minimal. So the challenge was, how do you have that hold a 600-pound piece of glass, right? So that was something that took me back to, I also have a degree in engineering, to early statics, where, you know, you have a load of gravity, a gravity load, and you, so anyway, it ends up being balanced. Basically, the whole thing is carried on a, like a 2x3-inch block of plastic. And then it just has to be held from falling out of the frame, right? Mm-hmm. So that was fun, working all of that out. And at the final day, I think when we said, well, we're gonna now made it to the glass, we needed a plastic tenon.
Mm-hmm.
And fortunately, we had a plastics company just a half block away who has all of this great milling machine as well. Mm-hmm. And I went up there in the morning, and by the afternoon, he'd already made the pieces. for us. So anyway, again, collaborative thing. We actually didn't really know how it was all going to fit together,
right,
until we had the piece of wood, the piece of glass, and the steel.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to say, the backside of this drawing of Dan's has what looks like Newtonian physics calculations scribbled out on it to an insane degree, and that was very impressive to me because I felt comfortable going into it. Usually I go into a project like this and you don't know what's going to happen. And we talked about that.
Well,
and you
simple,
were okay right? with that, which was
yeah.
amazing, you know, because that is the thing. When you're pushing the boundaries, you're so afraid of failure. It was nice to do a project with another person who understands the risk
yeah.
and is willing to accept that, hey, this might not work, but look at these calculations. I
yeah.
think we're pretty good.
And if you notice closely, the summation of forces is always equal to zero.
Yeah. That's exactly
otherwise
what
it's moving.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was a fun challenge.
Well,
and it actually works.
It worked, yeah, first time.
And what I didn't want was, mostly when you have a really heavy door, like you'll see the entry doors here in the gallery, is it's put on swivels, you know, a pin at the top and a pin at the bottom. And I just really did not want that. I wanted it hinged just like an ordinary door, except it's an extraordinary door.
Right.
We did have to reinforce the wall with steel, but yeah. it swings on 5 inches.
Yeah, mm-hmm. smooth.
This is something that came up the other night at the panel discussion at MADE, which was really fascinating for me to hear you all talk about that. There were a number of you who are designer builders,
mm-hmm.
and that the design process doesn't just stop, it continues through the making.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that was certainly the case with this. In fact, it continued so far through the making mm-hmm. that it was still in process during installation. So
right.
Tom, maybe you can talk about what design decision ended up taking an entire day during the installation of
yeah.
this piece.
Yeah, so as you know, as we were putting it together, what had been spec'd for, so what you're seeing here on the right, you're seeing the wood, and then you're seeing one half of the steel pedestals that support both the wood and the glass, sort of a U shape. And there's two of those, one on each end, and with a bar between them.
And what had been spec'd for the top of that pedestal supporting the glass was that it was to be painted white, and then we were going to use a white rubber over the top of it in order to support the glass and prevent it from contacting the metal. As soon as we got the glass on there, it was obvious to everybody in the room that white was not a good choice at all. I had anticipated that the rubber might not work out the right way the first time, and so I ordered extra, and we tried it three or four different ways, lifting the 560-pound table and moving it and putting more rubber under it and trying it again. Ultimately, we abandoned that white rubber altogether, and I made a couple calls and made an afternoon trip to a rubber supplier in town, and we got some black rubber, and we put some black rubber in there instead, and it's a huge improvement. But yeah, you know, it's sometimes until you see it in place, you don't realize what the impact of the design decision that was made months ago is going to be, and so yeah, you're designing right up to the end.
Yep. So design to material, and again, our two basic materials were glass and wood. And from the start, the thing that I think Dan, you alluded to this earlier, that was really interesting to me was this sort of the commonality of the origins of the material, in that the kind of glass that we make has a live edge to it. It has an edge which shows the heat history. It's where you see every evidence of how that material came from a liquid into a solid. Likewise, the live edge of the wood was fascinating. And this is, besides the Zena Forest, Bo turned us on to an amazing place here in town called Gobi.
Gobi Walnut, right. So Gobi goes and they get trees from arborists all around the state at this point. They've gotten pretty popular because they pay for trees that people are taking out. So these are trees that are not coming out of the middle of beautiful forests. There's going to be a development somewhere. They have to clear cut some trees. There's neighborhoods where trees blow down or they have insect infestations. So different reasons they get these trees. But rather than what used to just get chopped up for pulp, they're actually slabbing them and getting these beautiful, thick pieces of wood that we can make all different types of projects out of. So, and they've caught on, I mean, they're shipping their slabs all over the country.
And they actually have the history of all these slabs. If they don't have one,
they make one up, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
You know, like our slabs,
yeah, they'll tell you some farm or something.
With,
yeah.
Lewis and Clark or something.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Anyway. But no, they usually do, they can give you a good idea of where it came from.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. We still have to find out where this one came from. But we use two types of woods primarily, the Oregon white oak from the Zena Forest, and then this, the maple slabs that we got from Gobi.
Right.
In terms of those materials, how are they as wood materials?
It's interesting, like most Oregon woods, and I don't know what it is about the Oregon soil, but they aren't, when you think of maple, Oregon maple is not at all like maple. When you think of oak, Oregon oak is not at all like oak. They're very, and walnut as well, there's just a lot of varying colors in it. The densities are all over the place. There's a lot of tensions in them. I say that Oregon oak is a naughty wood to work with. Not naughty, but naughty, because it just does not behave. You plane it and you slice it and you joint it. It tears out on you. It bows right back to the shape it was. It's very frustrating to work with. But and that's why it's dirt cheap. I mean, it's $2 a board foot or something. You know, they're just getting rid of it. Because you go through, now this is not from Zena, his is actually not $2, because he treats his in a little bit of a different way, but you go through so much Oregon white oak to get what you need to yield. There's a lot of waste in it, because you're having to go mill it two or three times. Some pieces just don't work, and then there's also a lot of voids, which we tend to epoxy a lot of times, so there's all that added labor to it as well. So yeah, it can be a very difficult wood to work with, but the rustic nature of it just is unparalleled in my mind, so it's worth the effort.
It certainly was.
Yeah.
In terms of the glass, we really stayed with a very, very minimal palette. This may not look like a minimal palette because I asked for an image from our guy at the factory of of the various types of glass at Bullseye, and he gave me this every shade of bright hot pink. And that's not at all what we used. We used primarily clear glasses. Mm-hmm. So Dan, you want to talk about why that choice was in the palette?
Well, first of all, we wanted a very minimal look, and we were changing from a very colorful room with the Klaus Moyet piece in the black background. So we selected clear and gray. Doesn't get more minimal than that.
But of the forms of glass that were used, Tom, you had to work with mm-hmm. everything from sheet to billet to frit. Mm-hmm. And actually on the table, you had choice to do it a few different ways, right?
Yeah, we got to try a couple different things out. With the exception of Stringer, we use just about every form of glass that we manufacture. But all for very particular purposes. We were using, a good example is the door. There were a few different material types in that. Along the edge where the interface between the wood and the glass takes place, that was a stack of sheet glass that was cut to match the contour of the wood. And then that surface was polished. And we selected that because it was going to have a lower bubble count and more transparency. So you can actually, from inside or outside, you can see through that as though it's a window. And you can also see into it and see into the edge where it's abutting the wood. So that choice was for the clarity. And then for the rest of that door, that's all frit. Different grain sizes of frit, and the frit traps bubbles, and the size and concentration of the bubbles varies depending on the size of the frit that you're using, frit being just crushed sheet glass. And so that was used to create that fade that you see. You see how densely white it is right up against the sheet glass band. And then it gets progressively more transparent, and it's also getting progressively more gray because gray frit was brought in the other direction. And all of that work was done actually by Dan. He was right in there in the kiln, laying all that frit up and banking it beautifully so that a perfect gradient.
And this is one of the three, the door is one of the three projects where the actual physical connection of the wood to the glass was so critical, and where I think we learned quite a bit with this one. And Dan, you already talked about it. It really required a third material, the steel strapping. And we worked with a brilliant metal worker,
Brian Creaney from Flux.
Amazing. He did a lot of other projects, including some fireplace work, the elements in the screen, mm-hmm. The base of the table. He was absolutely brilliant to work with. But in this, in connecting the wood here, besides the strapping, how physically did you, what sort of adhesives did you use, and what sort of challenges did those?
Oh, there was a lot going on there. So the connection between the glass and the metal, we'll start there. Dan mentioned a plastic tenon. The glass itself is two cast panels of glass that have been laminated together. So there's a layer of resin connecting those two pieces of glass. And before they were laminated together, we used a CNC machine to dress and square up the edges, make sure everything was perfectly sized, and then routed rabbets into the top and bottom of those panels so that when the two panels are laminated together, those become a mortise in the top and the bottom of the glass. And then that plastic tenon that Dan was talking about gets screwed into the metal, and the glass gets set onto that tenon. And that process, we had to take that apart and put it back together probably about six times before we got the tenon shaved down perfectly so everything fit nice and snug, and every time you do that with something that's 500 pounds, you know, it's another opportunity to mess something up and break something, which we didn't do, thankfully. But yeah, that's it's a tricky connection to make. And then, you know, once we got that dialed in, then getting the wood into position, and Bo and his team, they also put mortises in the bottom of the wood. And Brian had welded steel tenons onto the metal, and so all of that had to socket together perfectly and get an eighth of an inch gap between the wood and the metal. The wood and the glass. And then that gap was filled with a two-part silicone, a really crystal clear silicone, poured into that gap between the two of them, which has the effect of wetting the surface of the glass. And that provides for really good transparency. So you can actually see, not in this picture, but when you look through that polished area of glass right next to the wood, the light transmits all the way down to the wood itself rather than bouncing off of the internal face of the glass. Mm-hmm. So there were a lot of different connections that had to be made. And then, you know, of course, everything had to be sealed up as well. So caulking. Silicone caulking between the wood and the steel, and the glass and the steel, all the way around for weatherproofing. So, lots of connections.
Talking of mortise and tenons, this is something we never would have really thought about. Is really mating glass, using glass almost, you know,
right.
like a wood element, and this was totally your.
Well, yeah, I think it's because I'm a little bit naive about how glass works. So, you know, when we're designing, I'm just assuming, well, why don't you just, you know, mill a tenon into the glass? And Tom kind of looks at me like, So,
sure.
But yeah, but we did it. And it was a really fun experiment. We learned so much during this process because, first off, we had to do it post-finish. The doors were all done. They were all finished. They had the mortise in them. And we had not actually had enough time to do as much prototyping as I would have liked. So while the doors were being finished, we were prototyping and realizing, wait, we have some issues here. Like when you push the glass tenon into the door, into the mortise into the door, the epoxy, anything it touches, turns it into crystal clear glass because it's kind of frosted from the CNC. But if you imagine like what is like licking it, it would do the same thing. It's just once kind of a moisture hits it, it turns crystal clear. But it wasn't, we couldn't get it consistent. It was crystal clear here, but then it was fuzzy over there. And it just, honestly, it looked horrible. And I was a little bit paranoid. And so we're like, all right, well, we have to put enough epoxy on there that it's going to seal everything and touch every surface. Well, the last thing you want close to finished wood is epoxy, because if it touches that finish, you'll never get it off. And it will always be a shiny spot or something. So then Tom was like, well, why don't you use VHB tape, which is very high bond tape? Mm-hmm. And I've never used that as a masking agent because I've always thought, well, it's very high bond. Why would I put that on something if I need to take it back off? But it's clear. It's got a little sponginess to it. You can see everything that happens. And we were, after enough experimentation, we were able to use that and control it to where the epoxy came out in the perfect little bead all the way around. It wet everything just right. And because the VHB tape was there, we were able to just barely clean it out with a little knife. And it was perfect. So that was a really good learning experience for me.
Yeah, and we took a tremendous amount away from that as well. It's nice to be challenged. And in the artists that we work with and the artist residency programs that we do, it's one of the greatest pleasures that we have to work with people who are not familiar with glass and don't have a lot of inhibitions about what you can and can't or should and shouldn't do with glass. And so, we had the capability, we had the equipment to be able to route a tenon in the glass to mate to a blind mortise in the door. It just, you know, we just had never tried to do that before. So, you know, having somebody who says, well, hey, just why don't you just do it? And that, you know, that worked out fantastically.
And one of these is upstairs to look at too, right?
Yeah, there's a prototype upstairs.
I guess for me, one of the really surprising things was after this real desire to mate these materials, that I think one of the most successful, or you know, really successful of these projects was the one where we never really touched the surfaces. Mm. And this is the glass and the wood slab, which were eventually, what's the space in between the
three quarters of an inch.
Give or take. Yeah. Give or take.
And it just works brilliantly, not at all what we intended on the original design.
Right.
We were expecting to look through shiny glass and catch every little detail of the wood.
In the very first design iteration, I believe the live edges were on the outside.
Yes.
And then at one point when we were at Gobi looking at the wood, I think that was your idea. You were like, well, what if we put it on the inside?
Because I can throw the
And then everything down. Became a whole lot harder.
Yeah. Really?
Which became easier in the end because we left the space between them.
Right, yeah. Right.
So much for the actual fabrication of it. What, this is tools, guys,
right.
And tools. And Tom, you started to talk about something that allowed us to do the mortise tenon, but both, I think, Bullseye and May really pride themselves on their hand craftsmanship. Mm-hmm. And probably my favorite shot of handcrafting is this. That's
not staged.
No, that's a fabulous one. I don't imagine that's probably your favorite tool.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite tool?
You know, honestly, I don't have a favorite tool. It's kind of like bring them all together is what I love the most. I love just being familiar with tools enough to where you start to control them and you know what to expect and where the chaos might show up and you can tweak that out of it. We were joking about it. The tool we used the most on the project with you guys was our lower backs because everything was so heavy.
Yeah.
But if push came to shove and someone had to tell me what my personal favorite tool would be, it's a hand card scraper. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's a flat sheet of metal that you hone with what's called a burnisher. It's a very hard polished piece of metal to get just a little burr at the end of it. And you bring a piece of wood, especially if it's got a lot of figure in it, which this did, you can scrape it and it's just so delicate and small that you don't get any tear out. It just pulls up the perfect little curls. And what I love most about it is it's a piece of flat steel and it's, but it's so useful to have, so.
I like this because you can do it at home.
Yeah, right. I think actually you should have said, do not try this at home.
Yeah. And do not bring one of these home, Dan. This is probably the biggest piece of equipment to do the smallest element in this project.
Yeah.
This is just a section of this piece of equipment, which you guys want to talk about that one.
Time
sure. Sure. Yeah. So this is a CNC machine. It's essentially a milling machine for glass. It uses diamond tooling, and it's a five-axis machine. So it's really versatile. It can do a lot of different things. Right now in this shot, what it's doing is it's taking one of the blanks that we cast for those door pulls, for the cabinet door pulls. And it's just flattening one side of it, but it's flattening it to a precise thickness so that the glass just perfectly matches the thickness of the door. And then after that process is done, the piece gets clamped vertically, and then all of the rest of the machining to create that tenon happens. We've got a piece of equipment like this. We've got a CNC glass cutter, which scores the glass. And what I kind of love about these machines is that there's nothing that they're doing that you couldn't do by hand, and that we haven't done by hand for years and years. It just allows you to do things with a greater degree of precision and predictability, and much, much faster than you would be able to do it by hand. So, you know, we still do a lot of handwork. We still do a lot of things, we finish a lot of things by hand, even if they come out of this machine. The polishing is done by hand because that's just the best finish that you can get. This really enabled us to do things that we wouldn't otherwise have been able to do practically for this project. Critical to the connections.
And speaking of finishes, this pretty much takes us to as far as I'm going to take this, other than to just remind you where we started, where we came from. That was us back then. This is us now.
Yeah, looks nice.
And it's a joy. It is a major joy to be living in this space. And it is everything that we really dreamed it would be. And at some point we'll get a professional photographer who can really capture it.